All right. Good morning, Calvary Wellspring. Would you go ahead and stand with us? And I'm going to go ahead and start us off with a call to worship. Reading in Psalm 97, it says, "The Lord reigns, let the earth rejoice. Let the many coastlands be glad. Clouds and thick darkness are all around him. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of his throne. Fire goes before him and burns up his adversaries all around. His lightnings light up the world. The earth sees and trembles. The mountains melt like wax before the Lord of all the earth. The heavens proclaim his righteousness, and all the peoples see his glory." So let us proclaim his righteousness and goodness and sing praises to him this morning. Again. Take a seat. right. Good morning, guys. So happy you're here. Those of you that are watching with us online and those of you that are here in person, I want to tell you first and foremost, it is such a blessing and a joy to be with you this morning, worshiping our Lord and Savior. Just a couple announcements for you. First, we've been pressing hard with these, the cards, because we want you guys to fill them out. This first one, this blue one, is just a way to connect with us. If you just put your name, email, phone number if you want to, one of the elders here, one of the leaders, will reach out to you just to touch base. Also, if you want to know more about what we do here at Wellspring, what we're all about, any events or things like that that come up, we send those out via emails. And this is just a way to keep connected with us. Also, if you've had any information change, this would be a great way to update that. Next on here is we have this ministry teams. If you've been attending here at Wellspring for a long time and you want to find out more about what it means to serve here, opportunities that are open, let me tell you, we've got plenty of opportunities open for people to serve. This is a great way to just put on your name, your email. We've got some listings here of some different ministries. If you'd like to serve in those, we'll touch base with you on that, but this is a great way to start that conversation off. And then the last one here is our prayer cards, and we encourage everybody to fill these out. We all have prayers. We all have needs that we need us as a community to come together and petition to our Lord for, and this is a great way to let us know what your needs and prayers are. So if you could fill that out today, there's a box in the back. You can fill it out. There's some pens. Put it in that box, and we'd love to have a conversation with you or pray for you as well. Now, would you go ahead and actually, one last thing before we get going. Community groups, they're starting back up. I'm really excited. So we will have next week some signups in the back for those community groups if you would like to join. If you want to know about what is community group, what is that, what do those look like, feel free to come chat with myself, chat with Luke, chat with Kevin, any one of us. And we'd love to talk about more about what that is and how to get involved and plugged in. But again, signups will be on the tables next Sunday. And then the hope is that we'll get started on February 8th will be our first week. With that, if you want to go ahead and stand with us, we'll continue on in worship this morning. And I just wanted to share a little bit about this next song. We haven't done it in a little bit. And I think when I was planning out this week what songs we wanted, I think this one really kind of hit me hard. It's Lord, I Need You. And I don't know many songs that do a better job of expressing our need for Jesus. The first verse starts, Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. And I know that is so true for me when I feel this strain of not bringing things to the Lord, not bringing the struggles that I'm having to the Lord, not confessing my sin and my need for Him. My heart is just is troubled in me. It's a struggle, and I feel my life just disconnected. I don't know if you guys feel that same way. I would imagine you do to some extent. But we get this knowledge and this truth and this promise that in this moment of confession to our Lord, that He meets us there, and He meets us there with grace and with love and with mercy. And that is where we find our rest in giving up ourselves, our pride, our sin. We give that out to the Lord. That's when we find our true rest and satisfaction in Him. So let's sing this song together this morning. I need you, oh, I need you.
teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Yes, Lord, we come before you humbled this morning and how much we need you. Lord, I don't think that any of us at any point in time has fully been aware of how much we desperately need you, how much you care and provide for us, the blessings that you lavish on us daily, God. But Lord, I pray that you would help us to see that, to know that you are here in all circumstances, working for our good, for your glory. Lord, and we pray that you get all the glory and honor this morning. It's in your name that we pray. Amen.
Is not in what I own, not in the strength of flesh and bone, but in the costly wounds of love at the cross. My worth is not in skill or name, in win or lose, in pride or shame, but in the blood of Christ that flowed at the cross. I rejoice in my Redeemer, greatest treasure, wellspring of my soul. I will trust in him, no other. My soul is satisfied by him. Eternal calls to us at the cross. yours, ear that I confess my worth and my unworthiness, my value fixed, my ransom paid. Rejoice in my Redeemer, greatest treasure, wellspring of my soul. I will trust in Him, no other. My soul is satisfied by Him alone.
Say that again.
I rejoice in my Redeemer, greatest treasure, wellspring of my soul. I will trust in Him, no other. The mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me. Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. Body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your body began to breathe. Out of the silence,
Yes, Lord, we proclaim you our living hope this morning, God. Lord, though we don't do that every day, it is true no matter what. You are our living hope. Lord, we ask you this morning that we would cling on to your word, that we would find the truth in it, and that we would rejoice in knowing you more today. And Lord, I confess that I am bringing in my own distractions this morning, and that my thoughts are not always on you, God. So I pray for myself, for us, that we would fine-tune our minds, that you would fine-tune our minds to focus on you this morning, to fix our eyes on you. For you are worthy of it, God, and we so desperately need you. It's your name that we pray. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
Right. Today's scripture reading comes from Ephesians 4, verses 11 through 16. And he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until we attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, so that we may no longer be children, tossed to and fro by waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness and deceitful schemes. Rather, speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and held together by every joint with which it's equipped, when each part is working properly, makes the whole body grow so that it builds itself up in love. This is the word of the Lord.
Amen. Thanks, David. Well, good morning, Calvary Wellspring. Good morning. It's good to be here with you this morning. It feels a little bit weird to be here and not be wearing a mask for the first time in a long time. So it's great to be with you. Thanks for joining us this morning. My name is Luke, if we haven't met before, and welcome online as well. If you are new here, you may not be aware, but this is my first week back teaching in months and months and months. My wife and I have been on sabbatical for the last kind of 4 months, from September through the end of December. Our time of sabbatical was incredibly restful. We read a lot of books. We did a lot of hikes. COVID made things interesting, but COVID always, makes things interesting, doesn't it? And we've just been trusting throughout the sabbatical and the weirdness of the season that Jesus knew exactly what he wanted to do in us. And I'll tell you that Jesus was incredibly kind to meet with us and bring us a bit of renewal, which for us was desperately needed. So thank you so much for your generosity in giving us some rest. And at this point, we want you to know that we are so excited to be back. We're excited to meet together, to see your faces, kind of, you know, through a mask, or not through a mask, but whatever, however that works. Excited to catch up, excited for what God has in store for Calvary Wellspring as we think and we dream and we hope and plan for the future. And that's a bit of what we are here to do this morning. For those of you who have been around the last few weeks, you know that we're currently working our way through a mission vision series, preaching series here at Calvary Wellspring, where we are looking at our mission and our vision and our values. And I don't know about you, but right now, for me, I'm in need of some reminding of who we are. Because the last year, man, it's just thrown me off. And if I'm honest, it can be easy to look around Wellspring and to wonder, man, what happened, right? I mean, we in so many ways, we were a different church than we were 1 year ago. There's been a lot of change around here. We've seen a couple church plants planted. We have sent away a family to start a seminary. We've sent away a couple other families to go do long-term work in South Asia. There's been a lot of change that we've seen happen here. And in the midst of it, for those of us who have stuck around Aurora, it's just you throw COVID on top of that. And I think maybe Some of us are wondering, man, is this thing really worth it? What are we still doing here? Everybody else is gone. What are we still doing here? Is this worth it? And the short answer is yes, it is absolutely worth it. It's absolutely worth it. But I think it's helpful every once in a while for us to remind ourselves again of the basics, like who we are and why we are here and why we do what we do and what we are here for. And this is precisely what a mission vision series is all about. And so if you haven't checked out any of the other mission vision sermons over the last number of weeks, I'd encourage you to do that. And before we jump into today's sermon, which is on the subject of grow, I want to open us in prayer. Lord, thank you so much for your goodness to us. We're thankful that you are the one that leads us and guides us, Lord, that you know the future and you know us. And you know how to get us from where we are to where you want us to be. And so this morning, as we sit under your word, Lord, we pray that you would be the one to speak to our hearts. Lord, we pray that you would be the one to transform our minds and renew our hearts, that you would give us the ability to hope again and to think again, and even in the midst of the world and the chaos that we live in, Lord, that you would cut through the messiness and remind us of who we are and remind us of where you are taking us. And I pray, Lord, that you would receive all of the glory and all of the honor and all of the praise. We pray this in your name. Amen. Amen. Well, if you have your Bibles, you can go ahead and grab them and turn on your phone. And if you haven't already, you can turn to Ephesians chapter 4. And I'm going to go ahead and read the passage that we just read. I'm going to read it again in its entirety. And we're going to work through three big ideas that we see presented in this text today. So beginning in verse 11, Paul, the author of Ephesians, he writes this. And he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, so that we may no longer be children tossed to and fro by waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness and deceitful schemes. Rather, speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined together and held together by every joint with which it is equipped, when each part is working properly, makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. Point number one, the necessity of growth. And specifically when we say growth, we are speaking here of Christian growth. The first thing that we see here in this passage about growing is that it's just assumed by Paul that you and I, people who would be reading this letter, we need to grow. Paul is writing to a group who are already Christians, and for him it was assumed they need to grow. No one has arrived yet. Verse 12, it's assumed that the body needs to be built up. Verse 13, it's assumed that the church had not attained to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, nor had they attained to the mature manhood, or we could say womanhood, of the measure of the fullness of Christ. And this is, of course, why Paul would tell the church in verse 15 that they need to grow up, right? This is not just unique to this church in Ephesus. Right? If we read through the rest of the New Testament, we see all the writers of the New Testament saying similar things to believers, to followers of Jesus. Peter, in 1 Peter, you might remember this from going through the book of 1 Peter, he says in 1 Peter 2, like newborn babies crave pure spiritual milk so that by it you may grow up in your salvation. The writer of Hebrews would say in Hebrews 6, therefore let us move beyond the elementary teachings about Christ and be taken forward into maturity. Paul, again, in Colossians chapter 1 would say this, and he's praying when he says it, we continually ask God to fill you with the knowledge of his will through all the wisdom and the understanding that the Spirit gives, growing in the knowledge of God. The list goes on and on. It's throughout the New Testament, and I'm guessing that this is not new information for you. One, that it's in the New Testament, and two, that you need to grow, right? Most of us, I think, are keenly aware that we have not arrived, that we are not finished products, that we are not perfect yet, that we are works in progress. I love what R.C. Sproul has mentioned about this in his book, Chosen by God. I'm going to throw the quote up behind me so you can read it with me. He says this, when we speak of finding Christ, the irony is this. Once we have found Christ, it is not the end of our seeking, but the beginning. Usually when we find what we're looking for, it signals the end of our searching. But when we find Christ, it is the beginning of our search. The Christian life begins at conversion. It does not end where it begins. It grows. It moves from faith to faith, from grace to grace, from life to life. This movement of growth is prodded by a continual seeking after God. And this is why when Jesus would speak of his followers, he would often refer to them as, what would Jesus refer to his followers as most often? Disciples. Disciples, right? And you may know this, but a disciple literally means a learner. So very practically, if we are disciples, it means that we have not arrived yet. We have more to learn. We don't know everything. We don't have all of the answers. So if you ever meet a Christian who thinks that they know all of the answers, you can just remind them again that they are disciples. And if this is true, then it means four things, really practically, that should characterize us as individuals and as a church. And I'll make these quick for the sake of time this morning. First, knowing that we are disciples and we haven't fully arrived should produce in you and I a great humility. If we recognize that we don't have all of the answers, it means that we need to be willing to listen to perspectives that are different than our own. Humility means that we should be quick to listen and slow to speak. It means that we should have an open mind and an open heart as we seek to follow Jesus in his way. I mean, if we think of it this way, if we are learners and we are growing, it means that there is a good chance that we will come to have different ideas about some things in the future than we do right now. Right? This is just part of growing. I've heard it said in this respect that Christians should therefore be the most open-minded of people. Right? We follow a risen Savior. And what could make a person more open-minded than believing that God himself became a man, that he lived on this earth, that he died on the cross for our sins, and then he rose again to new life. Often, God's ways don't fit inside the small boxes, I think, that we put him in. Are we humble people? Second, knowing that we are disciples and that we haven't fully arrived, really practically should produce in us a grace towards others. How do we treat people who are different than us? Different than us politically, different than us culturally, different than us theologically, different than us socioeconomically, different than us. You see, if this truth is applied across the board, it calls us to remember that others, especially if they're Christians, they too are learners. They're people in progress, right? They're people also who have not arrived. And I think how we treat others shows us a lot about how well we've let these truths actually sink into our hearts. Are we known as people who show grace towards others? Third, knowing that we are disciples and we haven't fully arrived should produce in us a grace for ourselves. I don't know about you, but for me, this one is extremely hard for me. It's way easier for me to show grace towards other people than it is to show grace for myself. If you know me, you know that I am a strong perfectionist. I want to be perfect always. I have a tendency to take myself way too seriously. And I will tell you that this is, first, not helpful, and second, not healthy. I need to constantly remind myself that I'm still a learner, that it's okay when I make a mistake, that I'm not perfect. And as a person who is growing, there is still room for my actions to catch up with perhaps my intellectual assertions. And you know what? This is another thing I have to remind myself. God loves me and accepts me fully and completely, despite the million ways that I mess up on this journey towards Christ-likeness that he has me on. And the same goes for you. If you're like me, then we need to show ourselves grace. I mean, this is fundamental to what it means to be a disciple, to be a learner. Are we people who give ourselves grace? Fourth, and finally, knowing that we are disciples and we haven't fully arrived means that growth is not optional, right? If we are to be disciples, or we could say learners, and yet if we were to fail to learn, well, actually, then it would mean that we are failing to be a disciple, if that makes sense. Growth, it's actually woven into the very fabric of our relationships with Jesus. And in this way, growth, spiritual growth, is always a sign of spiritual health. And when we think more broadly, this just makes sense. Erica and I just bought a house. If you didn't know that, I think probably most of us know this, but we've just bought a house, and so we've been thinking about landscaping. We don't have any trees in the backyard, and it's just, well, there's one, and we don't like it. It's an apple tree, and we don't need an apple tree. We want pines. So anyway, long story short, we have thought about landscaping a lot this last year, and one of the things that we have thought, we've learned in this whole process is that if we buy a plant or we buy a tree or bush or whatever, and we plant it in our yard, and after a year it has not grown, there is a good chance that that plant or tree or whatever it is either dying or it's already dead. Why? Because growth is a sign of life. Growth is a sign of health. And the same is true for our Christian growth. If we are not growing as believers, there is a good chance that we are dying. A lack of growth is an indication that something is seriously wrong. And so I'd ask you, what does your growth into Christ say about your spiritual health here this morning? So here in this passage, we absolutely see the necessity of Christian growth. In fact, if we look at verse 14, Paul comments that without growth, there are very serious consequences. What does he say? Well, in an illustration of children who have not yet matured, Paul comments that immature Christians are tossed to and fro. First, by their environment, or we might say their culture, and second, by human cunning and deceit. Now, this is not a knock or a dig against kids. We love kids, right? We love kids. But it's just the truth that kids are swayed all over the place by their emotions and by their environment. They can go from laughing to crying in like 2 seconds. For young Christians, the same is true. They can go from hot in their faith to cold in their faith without the stability that comes with spiritual maturity. And this isn't all. Also, like children, the spiritually immature can also be a bit gullible, right? Children tend to accept everything that they hear as truth. Their filters aren't yet that discerning, especially if a presentation is slick or a speaker is powerful or a leader has a very large following and everybody else is jumping into what they're saying. Children are quick to get on board, to buy in, even if there is no actual truth in what is being taught. An immature Christian, those who are swayed to and fro by culture and by human cunning and deceit, I don't have to tell you, this is a dangerous position to be in. It's like a child who's left alone in New York City, right? There's so many predators out there looking to take advantage. And here, once again, we see the necessity of Christian growth. And so the question comes to us, are we all, as believers in this room and online, are we growing? Are we spiritually growing? Are we striving? Are we seeking to move forward? Or have we become content or even complacent with where our walks are with Jesus? Man, this is a matter of utmost importance for us as a church. So first we see the necessity of growth. Point number two, the nature of growth. Christian growth is always pointed in a direction, right? It always has in mind a goal. It's not aimless, right? There's a mission to the madness. And the goal, however, of Christian growth for many Christians, I think, is often misunderstood. Many Christians don't really understand the nature of Christian growth. And what I mean is this. Chances are, if we were just to leave this building and we were to go walk out and we're going to ask somebody on the street, what does it mean to be a Christian and to grow as a Christian? I think we would probably hear one or two of these two different misconceptions of Christian growth. The first misconception of Christian growth that we may hear is that growth is primarily about knowledge, right? This is the belief that maturity is primarily about what we know in our heads, and therefore the logic goes, if we just knew more, then we would be more mature. In particular, we as Americans, I think we love to lift up this model, because so much of growing for us as Americans has to do with education. With education as kind of the great American savior. We often see this in the church where it's just assumed that if someone has this degree or that degree in theology or religion, or they've read these books or they understand these theological concepts, then perhaps they are more mature. We also see this in Christian media, in marketing, right? Where if you just read this book or you take this class or you go to this seminar, that you will achieve a deeper relationship with Jesus. Now, hear me out here. I'm not saying that knowledge is bad. Of course, it is not bad. It is wonderful. We need more knowledge, right? Paul would even mention in verse 13 that he longs for this church in Ephesus to grow in their knowledge of Jesus. Knowledge, of course, is part of it, but it is not all of it. I've mentioned this before, but one of the top scholars in the Bible that I've ever known was a New Testament professor where I went to college. He knew the Bible just about better than anybody else in the world, but he didn't believe a word of it. His heart wasn't transformed by it. You see, we can't just assume that knowing more is going to make us grow as Christians. It just doesn't. The second misconception that we might find if we walked out on the street and talked to someone is that Christian growth is primarily about growing in deed or in actions or in what we do. This is the belief that maturity is primarily, again, it's about what we do, and therefore the logic goes, if we just did more, if I did more, then I would be more mature. And the problem with emphasizing this kind of growth is that it's really possible for us to put on a great show without our hearts ever being affected by this. Some of us may be so familiar today with trying so hard to be a Christian, trying, working to do all of the right things that we actually find our hearts weary and bitter with God. And I'm pretty sure that both Jesus and Paul would say that those who strive towards that kind of a model of Christian growth have missed the point. It's just another form of Phariseeism or works righteousness that alone is not enough to cause any of us to grow or to really reveal any true maturity, at least in the terms that Paul is teaching us or leading us towards here in this text. Now again, don't get me wrong, doing good works is a fruit, actually, of Christian growth. It's incredibly important. Paul would mention the importance of unity in verse 13 and love in verses 15 and 16. Good works are incredibly important, but when taught in isolation, they ultimately let people down. I mean, it hurts me to think about how many people have been sold a false version of Christian growth, of what it means to be a Christian, where they place the emphasis in either one or both of these two misconceptions. No, Paul, instead of pointing us to knowledge or works alone, he points us to a much higher goal in this text, doesn't he? He aims our growth in a much more ambitious direction. Verses 13 and 15, where does he aim us? If you look at your text, what is the goal of Christian growth? What would you say? Any ideas? Be like Christ. Yes, exactly. Christ himself. Knowing him and loving him and growing to be like him. Jesus is our aim. Growth, therefore, is less about doing and more about being or becoming, right? It's about who we are. It's about our identity. It's about our motivations. It's the kind of growth that reshapes who we are at the core. Christian growth's goal is about transforming into Christ. And this goal of transforming into Christ should reshape our expectations significantly as we consider the nature of our growth. So two things I want to mention here. First, how are we doing? We doing all right? All right. I love this. You guys are the best. So fun to be with you this morning. So first, if Christian growth is about transforming into Christ, it means that growth will not be immediate. Does that make sense? Like, the goal is just so lofty that it's not going to be a quick process. This is why we see in today's text statements like, until we attain, in verse 13, or that we may no longer, in verse 14, or that we are to grow up in every way, verse 15. And why I think this is so important for us here in this room in particular is because we all live in America. And America is the land of microwaves, right? It's the land of on-demand TV. It's the land of Facebook and text messaging, instantaneous feedback loops. It's a land where if you want it, you can buy it on Amazon and it'll be on your doorstep in 2 hours, right? Like I don't know about you, but I've been cultured and I have been conditioned to want and to expect things now. I don't do well with waiting. I'm not known for my patience. I'm hopefully growing in this. But it's a slow process. I don't know if you're with me on this, right? But growth, we have to understand, it doesn't operate on these American time schedules. Growth, Christian growth, is very rarely microwavable. Yes, God sometimes does a miracle, but typically it's the opposite of microwavable. Right? It's actually uncomfortably slow, excruciatingly slow, painfully slow. It seems like it takes forever. God is working to transform the very depths of you and I, and I think we often neglect to understand the depth of change actually necessary to take us from point A to point B along the path towards maturity. And I'm surprised when it actually takes years. Years. In this text, I think Paul is working to help us understand this as he uses the illustration of a child in verse 14. As a metaphor for our spiritual growth. Growing children into maturity, parents, you guys all know way more than me, but it's not an overnight thing, right? Like, it takes years. It takes years and years. You can't microwave children. That's a bad thing. It's a really bad thing. Likewise, Christian growth is this process by which the truths that we have learned in our heads and the deeds that we have begun to live out, they actually begin to be worked so deep into us that they begin to affect our disposition and our temperament and our loves and our affections, our very identity. You know, when we think, therefore, of Christian growth, I think we need to think of it as a marathon rather than as a sprint. I love what Eugene Peterson said in his seminal book on discipleship that is aptly named. I think it's the best title of a book ever. A Long Obedience in the Same Direction. That's his book on discipleship. Great name. He says this in this, and I'll throw it up again on the screen behind me. He says, there's a great market for religious experience in our world. There is little enthusiasm for the patient acquisition of virtue. Little inclination to sign up for a long apprenticeship in what earlier generations of Christians called holiness. I think that's true. What Peterson's reminding us is that growth is not immediate. So first, if Christian growth is about transforming into Christ, it means that growth is not immediate. Second, it means growth is not easy. My wife and I, we love to climb mountains. Many of you know this. And typically, the higher the mountain, the more difficult the climb. And Paul here, by putting Christ himself as the object and the goal of our growth, he's placed an enormously large mountain in front of us to climb, a mountain of infinite height. I mean, Paul could not have given us a higher goal for our growth as believers, could he? I mean, Jesus is perfect. He is holy. He is the ultimate standard. He is God himself. He is the perfect embodiment of true love. These are the heights to which you and I have been called. If this is true, we should not expect the road ahead to be easy. I think there's a reason that Paul in Philippians chapter 2, verses 13, he does not say God wills and acts for our good pleasure, but rather that God wills and acts for his good pleasure, right? God is good and we can trust him, but following Jesus, growing in Jesus, it doesn't always feel pleasurable, right? Any of us who have been Christians for a long time, we can say amen to that. It doesn't always feel pleasurable. I don't know about you, but growth for me has not gone according to my plan. You know, if I was planning my own Christian growth, I would have gone a lot more linear with it, right? Just straight towards Jesus. But what I find is that my trajectory of Christian growth is a little all over the place. It's not linear at all. Some days are good days where I wake up and I'm singing worship songs. Other days, they're just not that good. And Erica has to live with me on these days, and I feel sorry for her, right? Following Jesus for me is often a struggle. I find my heart waging war against God, against his plans. I fail so often to trust in him. And what I have to remember is that even here, this is all part of my own growth into Christ, right? God is teaching me faith when I can't see. He's teaching me not to rely on myself. He's teaching me to depend on him, even when it's hard to keep going. See, the strange thing is, I think often the places where you and I, where we grow the most, are the places where we struggle the most. The times where God reveals to us hard truths about himself, or ourselves, or us. Excuse me, I should say that. About us, not about him, but about us. He's awesome. So, you know, sometimes that might be hard to grasp, but he's awesome, but sometimes he reveals hard truths about us, and then he calls us again to trust him and to surrender to him as we seek to move forward in his strength. Growth, friends, it's just not that easy, right? Now, I don't know about you, but at this point in the sermon, I can tend to feel pretty depleted because here's the thing. We know that we need to grow, but man, the path of growth is both long and it's hard. And the goal is impossibly high. And that can feel pretty daunting. I don't know about you, but that's where I'm at. But friends, there's good news for us yet. Actually, incredibly good news for us. And this is what the third point of today's message is all about. You guys ready for this? Yeah? Yeah? Okay. Doing good? All right, let's keep going. Point number three, the graces of growth. Good news. God knows better than anyone what an immense task our growth is in him. And for this reason, he doesn't leave us alone in this process. You, friend, are not alone in your growth into Christ. He's given us graces. And I say graces because he's given us multiple gifts to help us, to carry us forward into the lofty heights of our personal growth into Christ-likeness. For our purposes here, I want to highlight three different graces. Three graces, which I believe are the most important graces, I think, to understanding our growth into Jesus. The first two graces Paul doesn't highlight in today's text, but they are mentioned earlier in the book of Ephesians, and they serve as a foundation for understanding the third grace that we actually do see in today's text. So if you have your Bibles, you can flip back a page. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13. We see the first grace mentioned here. Paul says this, "In him," they're speaking of Jesus, "you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation." The first grace or gift that God gives to us for our growth is his word, the scriptures, right? The scriptures are our foundation. They have been given to us so that our knowledge of God might be actually built upon what is true. As Paul comments, they are a word of truth. They therefore are our rule, our authority, our standard for knowing God and growing in him. But as we've said before, if growth is ultimately about a relationship, the scriptures are more than just some tool to be mastered. Ultimately, they are a gift of God for the purposes of worship and for the purposes of relationship. Grace number two. We'll keep reading. Paul is speaking to the Ephesian believers, and he says, "You were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of his glory." So the second gift of God for the purposes of growth is actually the most important one, right? Paul reminds us here of the Holy Spirit. He comments, these Christians were sealed, past tense, by the Spirit, and the Spirit is therefore the guarantee of their inheritance, which is what is to come, right? Past and what is to come. And what we have to remember here is that our growth is ultimately something that God has initiated in the past, that he is directing in the present, and that will be sustained for the future. So many of you guys may be familiar with this, but when the Bible speaks of salvation, there are three big words that the Bible often uses to describe what is going on. Three big words to describe how we are being saved. The first one is justification, right? Justification literally means to be justified, like someone would be justified in a courtroom. And this is a specific moment, split-second period of time where the Spirit initiates new birth and new life into the heart of a believer. Second, the Bible speaks of sanctification. And sanctification literally means to be made holy or to be made set apart. It's a little bit different, right? Sanctification is anything but a split-second work. Right? It's a lifelong work as God's Spirit very slowly reshapes believers more and more, both outward and inwardly, into Jesus' image. So when we talk about growth, it's sanctification primarily that we are speaking of. This is part of God's salvation. The third word is glorification. Glorification. And glorification literally means to be glorified. And it's the final, God's final removal of sin from those who believe after we die, and then we go to be with Jesus. And what I want us to see here is that all three aspects of our salvation are ultimately initiated by God and then carried forward by God through the power of the Spirit. This is why Paul would say and pastorally remind the church in Philippi, if you remember, in the midst of their difficulties in growth into Christ, he would remind them that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion. You see, it's God who ultimately brings the growth, who brings maturity, and therefore we can trust him even as we strive ourselves that he's going to faithfully lead us. So I don't know about you, but when we look at our lives and we wonder, man, how did I get here? How can God use me here? We don't have to have any fear. God is never surprised by our shortcomings. He knows us. He cares for us. He meets us right where we are. Hope is not lost. And therefore, as it concerns our growth, we should be the most optimistic of people, right? As we trust the Spirit to continue to lead us forward and ultimately complete what he started. Such good news. But the Word and the Spirit are not the only graces that God has given to us. God has given us another gift that is absolutely essential to our growth as Christians. Actually, it's this third grace that is the thrust of Ephesians 4. So if you want to flip back in your Bibles, Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 16. And I'm going to ask for some feedback again. What do you see, what theme sticks out about how we grow as Christians from this passage? What do you see? What would you say is the primary theme about how we grow as Christians that's seen in this text? Together, the church. Yeah, exactly. Christian growth is absolutely connected to the local church. You can't separate it. God has given us the church. He's given us a group of people to help us grow. And we see this in this text in two primary ways. First, we see in verse 11 that God has given people in the church gifts, right? For the equipping of the saints, for the building up of the body. Now, often, the five gifts that we see here at the very beginning of this passage, they're thought of as offices in the church. But Paul actually here doesn't present them as such. Rather, Paul tells us of people who have been given gifts to help the church. And the truth is, even if we look at this short list of five gifts, and we think to ourselves, well, I don't have any of those gifts, Paul would mention elsewhere all kinds of other gifts, right? Serving or encouraging or giving or mercy or wisdom, knowledge, faith, healing, miracles, tongues, to name a few. There's all kinds of different gifts that God has given to his followers, not for their own sake, and that's Paul's point here. It's not for their own sake to make themselves great, but rather, verse 11, he gave them for the building up of the body for others. But our gifting is just part of how God uses the church for our growth, right? We also see another thing in verse 15. The church grows by speaking the truth to each other in love. Paul is telling us that this is another aspect of how we grow, to speak to one another two things, truth and love. Truth and love. It has to be both, right? To speak truth without love is to hammer someone with content so that they probably hate you and they're not going to listen to what you have to say, therefore doing no good. Or second, to love without truth is to speak empty words that actually have no content and therefore, once again, not really doing anyone any good. Growth into godliness happens as we pair these two things together, truth and love, and we learn to speak them to one another. Now, this may seem like a nice sentiment, right? But for any of us who have actually tried this, we know that Paul is actually making this sound much easier than it is, right? It's not so simple speaking truth and love. And so how do we do this? How do we grow in this? What does this practically look like for us here as a church? I would suggest this. I would suggest if you're really interested in doing this, you should join a gospel community, which we talked about at the very beginning. We'll have sign-ups the next couple weeks. A gospel community is a co-ed group of men and women that study the Bible together, get together once a week on average. Or I would recommend also you could join a DNA group, which are even smaller groups that are either just men or just women, where we pray for one another and, you know, there's accountability. This is why I say this. Join one or both of the groups. We'd recommend both because, you know, more is better. But this is why I say this. One of the sayings that we say around here is that truth travels best the road of relationships. Truths, hard truths, are not just something that we can hear from anybody, right? This is why Facebook can be such a nightmare these days, right? Because all these people are sharing truths to one another without actually knowing one another or actually loving one another. Sociologically, there's a principle that truth is going to be understood by those who have earned trust over time. Speaking like this with real love and real truth, it always works best in deep relationships, in deep friendships. And so I would ask you, who at Wellspring have you given the privilege of speaking into your life? And with whom at Wellspring do you have the privilege to speak into their life? And I would say that the way that we answer these two questions are telling not only to the degree that, to which we would understand how well we are connected here, which is important, but even more importantly, the degree to which you and I are growing. Are you a part of a GC or a DNA group? If we're serious about our growth, I can't tell you how essential deep friendships and community are towards propelling us forward into Christ. And when we do these two things, look at what Paul says in verse 16. When each part is working properly, the church there, I'm kind of adding that in just so we understand what's going on here, the church makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. Man, what an incredible image. Now again, this is, I think, easier. It sounds easier than it actually is. Notice Paul's words, when each part is working properly. This means every person is working properly. If you were here last week, James preached an incredible message on connecting where he spoke into this exactly. And he called to mind a puzzle, right? Where he reminded us that we are all puzzle pieces in the bigger picture. And no one of us is more important than the others. And here's the thing. The puzzle is ultimately not complete until the whole all the pieces are plugged in and doing their part, right? Paul tells us this is a major part of our growing into Christ. Growth happens as we as a church, as we link arms, we share our gifts, and we speak love and truth together. This is a high calling for a church, there is no doubt. Yet imagine what being a part of a church like this could look like. The ways that we could encourage and equip one another. The ways that we could engage in mission. The growth, the exponential growth opportunities, right? I mean, talk about making Jesus not ignorable. This would be incredible. But Paul reminds us that this vision takes everyone. Friends, your growth into Christ is absolutely correlated with your connection to the local church. And we can't grow without becoming unified and plugged in with his people. The body of Christ needs you just as you also need the body of Christ. for growth into Christian maturity as we all seek to build one another up in love. This is how this works. And friends, this ultimately is what we as a church at Calvary Wellspring, this is what we want to be about. We don't want to just go through the motions. We long that this become the reality for the way our church works. But I will tell you, we are not naive to the difficulty of the road ahead. In the midst of our world's chaos, right, where COVID has just messed with us all in a huge way. And in the midst, if that weren't enough, of us, all the changes that have happened here in our church as we've sent away so many families that we love. Right? And that's what we live for. We live for sending out families. We live to see Jesus made non-ignorable. Yet in the midst of all the celebrations of God's faithfulness and work, we want you to know that we're not unaware to the incredibly hard process in a lot of other ways that we've had to go through, that you've had to go through as a church, as we've said goodbye to some of our closest friends. And I think along with COVID, it can be easy to look at the church and to feel a little bit disconnected, to feel maybe left behind. If this is you, I want you to know I get it. It has been hard. And yet, what I believe with my whole heart is that Jesus is worth it. He's worth it. Whatever the cost, he's worth it. And second, that while growing together in this stage may be as difficult as ever because of all the changes, right? New trust needs to be built. New relationships need to be forged. Perhaps it's never been more important than it is now to press in. To step out of our comfort zones and to meet new people, jumping into GCs or DNA groups if we aren't currently part of one. And for those of you who have chosen to stay home, this may look like looking for new ways to meaningfully connect over Zoom or text or Facebook. I know it's going to look different for every one of us, right? But I do want to just press in and say, man, we want to be a people who are desperate to grow. And we recognize that to do that is something that we do together. We do it together. We link arms together as we seek to know him and worship him and love him. And so, friends, are we in? Are you in? Man, I long to do this together, and I'm so excited for what I believe the Lord wants to do in our church as we link arms and we seek to build one another up in love. Let me pray for us. Father, we are so grateful that you are the one leading the ship. Because sometimes we look ahead and it just seems so daunting. We feel so lost. And so it's good to remind ourselves that even in the midst of the things that are hard to see, as we look forward, that you are there, that you are present, and that you are leading. And the truth is, Lord, we need your leadership. Lord, I pray, Lord, that you would move in our hearts, move in our lives. Lord, that you would continue to grow our affections for you. Lord, and we trust ourselves and we trust our church to you. Lord, thank you for your leadership as we seek to grow into you. I pray this in your name. Amen. Well, as we continue, as we always do, we are going to partake of the Lord's Supper. This is a meal that Jesus instituted on the night before his death. He sat down with the disciples and he told them that the bread represented his body that would be broken for them, and the wine or grape juice in this case represents his blood that would be poured out for the forgiveness of sins. And we recognize this is ultimately the anchor for why we gather together. This is what brings us together as a church. This is why we continue to look forward to the great things that we believe God wants us to do is because of the hope that is anchored in Jesus' death and his resurrection. And so in the time that we have ahead, this is a time for us to spend personally with the Lord, repenting where we feel like there is sin, or where God is convicting us of sin, and then celebrating what Christ has done through his redemptive work. And so in the time ahead, we'll just have a little bit of music. Feel free to come forward to partake of the elements and then return back to your seat.
Would you stand as we continue in worship this morning? What a good word, Luke. Thank you so much, man. We're so grateful for you. It's good to have you back. Our last song we're going to be singing is My One Comfort. And I think it speaks a lot to what we just heard from the message this morning, in that while it seems daunting, the task that Christ has laid before us, there is such comfort to know that he's given us every tool that we need to become more like Christ, that being his word, the Spirit, and the church. So let's embrace those things together, knowing that Christ is coming alongside us, making us new every morning, renewing our hearts, and directing our eyes towards him. What a great comfort that is. So let's sing this morning.
Death is that I am not my own. I was bought with blood. I confess I belong to you alone. By the Father's good decree, Jesus, you delivered me. By your death is that I am not my own. I was born with blood. I confess I belong to you alone. By the Father's good decree, Jesus, you deliver me. By your Spirit set me free to follow you. Jesus, you have taken hold of me.
Stay standing for the benediction.
Good morning. I was thinking there's three things I want to say. First, why in the world do we do benediction? I think that's often, you know, we do lots of things on a Sunday morning and we say, well, we do this and this is why we do this and this is, you know, we sing, this is why. But oftentimes we don't ever say, why do we do a benediction? A benediction is really to remind us what we've just heard, and to send us out, to give us a reason for the week to continue and press forward. And so, as Luke is preaching, all I could think about was a verse that I read just recently, and it's in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3. Verse 5, it says, "May the Lord direct your hearts to the love of God and to the steadfastness of Christ." So this week, as you're going out, remember, yes, growth is necessary. It takes time. It's can be a challenge, but the reminder is that the love of God and the steadfastness of Christ, that He is steadfast always. So as you go out this week and you're focused on your growth in Christ, remember that the steadfastness of Christ is there always, no matter what. Let me pray and we'll go. Father, thank you again for this morning. Praise you, God, for your Son. And Lord, as we leave this place and we split off and we run home to watch some football, or we head to In-N-Out to get a burger, God, all the while we remember that you are good, that you are steadfast, and our desire is to become more like you. We love you. Amen. Have a great week.